Good morning.
Good morning.
It is a beautiful day to be in worship today. I'd like to welcome everyone on this joyous Christmas Eve morning. I invite you to rise as you are able to welcome the entry of the light, followed by the lighting of our Advent candles. C.S. Lewis wrote, "Once in our world, a stable had something in it that was bigger than our whole world." May we be a ray of light in this world, bringing love to all. I invite you to hear the words of Isaiah. "For a child is born to us, a son is given to us. The government will rest on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. His government and its peace will never end. He will rule with fairness and justice from the throne of his ancestor David for all eternity. The passionate commitment of the Lord of Heaven's armies will make this happen. Because of this promise, we light this candle as a symbol of the Prince of Peace. May the visitation of your Holy Spirit, O God, make us ready for the coming of Jesus, bringing us hope, peace, joy, and love. O come, Emmanuel." I invite you to be seated as we hear a piece of music from Lola.
Your baby.
Gracious God, the prophet said, come, and you came. You humbled yourself. You joined yourself to us. You put paid, O God, to a hope of generations. We take joy in that gift. God, too often that gift, that joy, lasts but a moment, even in our brief lives. I pray you, Lord, that the joy, that the hope, that the gladness will last, not for time, but for a year or more, so that we in turn may be a sign of hope that others may follow to the manger and your grace. I ask you now, Lord, to join.
kingdom come,
thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. I would like to let you know that at the back of the sanctuary in the narthex, you will find a plate on the table where you may leave your gifts, your tithe, your offerings, as God leads you to do so. I believe we have some music. Where are we going to have ushers? No ushers. Okay, Stephen's going to play something then. Stephen? Rise and sing our hymn of praise, Joy to the World, UMH 246. Son of the Most High, The Lord God will give him the throne of his ancestor David, and he will reign over Israel forever. His kingdom will never end. Mary asked the angel, "But how can this happen? I am a virgin." The angel replied, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the baby to be born will be holy, and he will be called the Son of God. What's more, your relative Elizabeth has become pregnant in her old age. People used to say she was barren, but she has conceived a son that is now in her sixth month. For the word of God will never fail." Mary responded, "I am the Lord's servant. May everything you have said about me come true." And then the angel left her. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Stephen. I needed that moment of meditation. Thank you for the beautiful hymn that you played for us, Carol. In our home, we have a cedar chest. You got one of those? In that cedar chest is a teddy bear. All the fur has been worn off by love. One eye is missing, but it's there. In our daughter's home, she has in a shadow box what is left of a bunny that was worn out through love. Matter of fact, that daughter that thought so much of her bunny got nicknamed Bunny for carrying her bunny. It was so much to her that when she left for school in the morning, she would leave Bunny by the door so that when she came back in, he was there. Ever been to Edinburgh, Scotland? On 42 High Street in Edinburgh is a building erected in 1874 as a museum. And just recently, the Scottish government did a total renovation of it to the tune of about £13 million. So there's a lot of money. And its name was, and has now been changed to some degree, Museum of Childhood. And in the museum are all sorts of toys and all sorts of tricycles and bicycles and wheelbarrows and, I mean, wagons and so forth. They're all there from all of the, or rather the elite of society's children that are there. It's in a museum showing you all of these marvelous toys. Over in one corner is a little glass case that has in it, believe it or not, a rather worn, raggedy doll. All it says on it is from a child in the slums of London, circa 1905. All of us have some sorts of things we think about. As a matter of fact, you and I are like the teddy bear. You and I are like the bunny. You and I are like the raggedy hand doll. When you realize that what we're all about, those pitiful little toys and pets turned into absolute beauty from the love that was given them. You say, we're those dolls, we're those bunnies, we're those teddy bears. Look at us. Who are we that God should love us so? Think of that. There is nothing to recommend us to God. Nothing but God's love for us. Love that came down at Christmas. And the Christmas story begins, as you heard it read, with a young woman named Mary, who was betrothed to a man named Joseph, who doesn't have a lot written about him, but he's part of it. He was a virtuous man. He was a descendant of David, as you heard read. And Mary and Joseph were residents of Nazareth and the town of Galilee. You realize the betrothal period in that day was for a year. No eloping. And the legality of that betrothal was the fact that if in that year's time had Joseph died, Mary would have been claimed as a widow. There was a legality of it all. But here we have this marvelous story of this young lady who was in early teens, and she was, you heard, read. She still was unprepared for what happened. Think about it. Put yourself in her place. There she was. And the angel came to her and told her all these things. Greetings, one favored by God. And all of a sudden you're wondering, I don't know about you, but if an angel appeared to me and out of the middle of nowhere and said, favored by God, I would wonder, uh-oh, when's the other shoe going to drop? But she didn't. What do you think of that? Luke tells us that Mary was truly troubled, very greatly troubled over what she was hearing. And then Gabriel said to her, do not be afraid. You find it a lot when an angel appears to us. The first thing they said to us is, don't be afraid. I'm already afraid. I'm just too late. But don't be. Don't be afraid. And Mary gave a very sensible response to what was about to occur to her. Here she was, a young teenage lady, pregnant by the Holy Spirit. How do you tell Joseph that? Imagine the predicament she's in. She gave a very sensible response, though. She says, how will this be? And Gabriel answered her and said, the Holy Spirit will cover you. You know, no wonder. To me, it's a beautiful story. I can't help but enjoy it. It's no wonder it has inspired millions of people over 2,000 years since its occurrence, with all of the songs, with all of the stories, with everything that's rising up from it because of this child. Angel Gabriel came to Mary. You see, angels are messengers of God. I know we always put them on and show them to have wings, but I'm not sure they have wings. If you go and look at A Wonderful Life, he didn't have wings, did he? But the thing about it is, it's not there if you know that angels are there. Artists have made great pictures of them, angels. And I was just looking through some of them I pulled out my fine arts college book. I still have it on my shelf. And I pull it down for every once in a while, particularly I want to see some of the paintings that Raphael and Michelangelo and all of these have done. And Da Vinci has done with his marvelous sculptures and all of these things. All because of what? Because of this. Do you read their angels? U.S. News from the USA Today, sometime back, told a story of an angel. In California, a lady had a little package by her door. And she opened up the package, and it was car keys. And it says, these are keys to your car. And she looked around, and yes, there was a car. But the thing about it is, it was signed and says, this is a gift to you because I love you. And it was signed, an angel of the Lord. Can you imagine what sign she put on her garage door? She didn't put on her door, the fact being is, thank you, my anonymous friend. She hung up on the door, thank you, God, for her new car. It was new to her. It wasn't new, but an angel had brought it to her. She acknowledged that the things ultimately come from God. Everything we have, she was acknowledging that. And that's what we're doing today here on Christmas Eve, acknowledging what came for us and what God has done for us. Which suggests to us that anyone in this room can be an angel. All of us can. Any human being. You see, Christmas angels for us, if you look around and find somebody who's, or someone whose life can make a little difference, make it a little brighter by doing something for them. That's what Gabriel came about when he came to Mary. He made her life, not at the very first moment, but made it even more beautiful than she anticipated. Because what she heard was all negative, right? We get that way. We do that. You see, she was a virgin betrothed to a very virtuous man, Joseph. We'll come back to that. But in the stumbling block for all of us, even for people in the church, even for pastors who stand in the pulpit as I do today, are smirking to themselves that this very idea of a virgin birth, they have trouble with it, even in the church. So I wonder why, if it doesn't say more about us than it does about Mary. I was looking at some of the things that are happening now. Y'all know that we have 3D printers now, right? Science has already developed from 3D printers organs that work in our body and literally work. I would not be surprised that anytime soon we will hear from some lab somewhere that we have developed this absolutely human-type body known as a humanoid. I was sending out Christmas cards on emails. Do you know what the first thing it asked me was? Do you want AI to write the message or do you want to write it yourself? I just all of a sudden deleted that company off of my list. Wanting me to, wanting AI, artificial intelligence, to write my statement in a Christmas card? I'm sorry. But that's where we are today. As a matter of fact, scientists today are getting a little frightened about AI because it does more. You see, they could possibly come about and make this human-like creature here, but there's one thing they can't put in that humanoid. They can't put a soul in it. The soul comes from God, and we can't put it there, no matter what we do or how smart we become. As a matter of fact, I don't know about you, but as I got to looking at this, I got to thinking about Frankenstein Monster. Y'all remember that? That's where we're going. It kind of scared you. I'm thinking of that. What I'm trying to say is that some of us have a picture of God that is way too small. If you think that science is wonderful and amazing, how about the God who created this amazing world? Think about the God that gave us the mind to be able to even develop AI. It had to come from somewhere. It didn't just happen. Seawater didn't just foam up and find out and make this creature. It didn't happen that way. I don't care. I taught evolution in college. I believe in organic evolution. That means that all the animals that are here today were here a million years ago because God developed them and we kept progressing. That's what our universe has done. Our universe isn't shrinking, it's expanding. God isn't through with us. Can you imagine? That's where we are. He wasn't through with Mary. Can you imagine those first statements to her? I don't know about you, but I'd have got a cold sweat if I was a teenager being told that I was pregnant. Can it be? We can do it because of God. Not because of our tinkering, but because of God. You know, the more we know about nature, the more I know about science, the more I stand in awe of God who gave us the gift of life. And I stand in awe of this marvelous universe that you and I inhabit today. I think of that. I get to thinking, is it too big a leap of our faith to believe God, who created these amazing bodies that we have, that we will inhabit who choose to have a son be born in a human? Come tonight, you can find out some new things about it. When you realize that the season is open, this season that we are in right now opens our hearts, it opens our minds, it opens our spirits, and we have this unique person that we're celebrating in Jesus Christ. And it changes our lives. Tell me it doesn't. If you know it, your life has been changed. So that's where it is today. Jesus Christ, he wants you and me to take our place in this world as a child of God. That's what he wants. That's what he said to us. You think a baby changed the world? The baby did. The angel came to Mary with this message that God, that she would bear a son. She didn't need a sonogram. Did you know that? The angel told her what the sex of the child was. You're going to have a son. Most of us don't know that up front, do we? When you realize it. But here it was. To me, it's a beautiful, one of the most beautiful and believable stories in the world. It's not because of the angels. It's not because of the shepherds. It's not because of Mary being a virgin. It's not because everything came about because Jesus was coming into the world. I think about what he really brought to us. John Ortberg is a theologian and a writer. He wrote a book called Six Ways That Jesus' Birth Changed the World. Well, he can only scratch the surface on what he said, six ways. Well, that's just something that we can wrap our mind around. But think about all the changes that came about because this child came into the world. When you and I look at it, that Jesus was the man like no other man that we can ever imagine. And when he came about, what did he do? The first thing he did, he began to change the status of children. That was one of the first things he did. And that's marvelous. And that's why I like this Museum of Childhood in Edinburgh. Edinburgh was there. But you think about it. In the ancient world, you know, children were just sort of, if they didn't like a girl, baby, they just left it. Went on their way. Jesus changed that. He changed it through all of us. A child is important. You have to, he says, come to me as a child. And then he also made an impact on education. When you think about education, when it was there in the ancient world, when you and I think about it, education was for the elite. It meant we wanted everybody to be smart. But Jesus says, wait a minute. That's why we have the Bible written the way it is so those people can read it. They can become educated. And that was one of the things he did. How many universities and medical centers do we have named because they came from an organization called the church? Look around you. When I think about it, I've dealt with many of them across this nation. There were the Catholic orders, there's the Baptist orders, there's the Methodist orders, there's the Lutherans. You name them, churches formed those, and it was through Jesus Christ that he brought this education to all of us. And then there's the notion of compassion. I don't know how you are, but if I see Christ, one of the adjectives there is compassion. It's there. Jesus' compassion for the poor and for the sick led to the intersection of the place like we had down in Carmel, Louisiana, for the lepers. I didn't have that before, but he brought that about. Then when you think about it, the virtue of humanity. Excuse me, of humility. When you think of humility, did you know that before Jesus came into the world, humility was not even considered a virtue? Did you know? It was not. Jesus' life as the foot-washing servant would eventually lead to the adoption of humility. Our lives. And along with that came forgiveness. He's the one who said, what was it? The major ones? Love the Lord your God with all your heart and all your soul. And what? your neighbor as yourself. To love them means you got to forgive them, right? I wish the divorce courts knew that. But we're there. The root of Jesus' life. You see, in the ancient world, virtue meant rewarding your friends and punishing your enemies. That's what it was. Imagine how shocking it would be when the humble preacher Jesus taught that what is best in life is to love your enemies and see them reconciled to you. What? You've got to be kidding me. Really? That's what he did for us. And then he brought us in the word that we probably don't think a lot about, and that's humanitarianism. When we think about humanitarian efforts and reform, you see, Jesus continually championed the excluded, those that are excluded, including women. Do you remember women didn't have a place? Slaves didn't have a place. Can you imagine a slave walking in and there was a slave master bend down and washing the feet of the slaves? Jesus brought that. It's important for us to understand. That's humanitarian. Again, this is not an exhaustive list. We could go on and on, and you would miss much. But when I consider the ways of this world that you and I are living in, how they were changed by this coming of this Christ child in and brought into this world and slept in a feeding trough. Can you imagine Mary turning that feeding trough into a cradle? That's what the Christ child did for us. I want to cry out with that centurion that was standing there at the cross at the very end when Christ died, and he said, truly, that man was the Son of God. That's what we are today. You see, the coming of Christ delivered into a whole new world. Imagine. You see, God's vision for the world is yet to be realized. We think we know it, but it's not done yet. His vision has not been realized. And I don't know if it's going to happen in our time or not. If it does, fine. But if it doesn't, I'm not going to be saddened because God is still expanding that vision in our lives. He's chosen to work in this world. And the reason it's not done is he's chosen to work in this world through ordinary people like you and me. And that's why we think of it. You know, respecting our freedom, giving you and me the right to say no. Just think. Mary had the right to say no. She could have denied it, but did she? She didn't. She said yes. Her response was to say, I am the Lord's servant. That's the response she gave. If I'm the Lord's servant, may your words to me be fulfilled. And that's why we sing Joy to the World and O Come Emmanuel, because she said yes to what God wanted done. You see, Christ touches the world as no one else has ever touched this world. Has he touched your life? I hope that he has. I hope that the message of Christmas, this Christmas, will invade all of our lives that it has never invaded before. And that you and I will join those who count themselves as his disciples, seeking to bring his kingdom to this world so that one day, the whole world will resound with the angel's song. That song, peace on earth, goodwill to all people, everywhere. the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Our hymn to send us forth this morning is number 240 in the red hymnal. Hark, the Herald Angels Sing. One verse. Say I love you, there's not a thing you can do about it. Lord, we're God's people, so all there.